is hot.
Oh yeah, don't worry about it. No one's ever said I'm too quiet. Don't worry. All right, we're gonna get going because we only have an hour and we have, I think, an incredible panel here. So I am Aron Pilhofer from Temple University, and the name of this panel is in your Facebook, and I'll be very honest about that. We started with the title and worked backwards to the panel, but that's okay because I think we have a lot to say today that I think you'll get something out of. Now, I'm going to go very, very quickly, and I'm going to let my fabulous panelists introduce themselves in order. But I'll start with a very short, if you could throw up the presentation, I'll sort of tee off the panel at any point. Can you put it up? All right. So. I'm going to tee off kind of what this is about, and as I was thinking about the Facebook problem, what I think is the Facebook problem, I sort of define this as a six stages of Facebook. And so Facebook, you know, when Facebook got on the radar of most publishers, I think it was exuberance. It was like, yay, awesome, Facebook, great. Then there was the inevitable backlash, so that's kind of stage two, Facebook sucks. Then I think you got very quickly into the Facebook is the root of all evil stage, which I think then led very naturally into the Facebook should be sending us all kinds of money stage, and where we are right now, which is I think the Facebook, let's just try to ignore it and maybe it will go away. Now, I don't mean this is everyone, but I do think that lost in all of this discussion about what Facebook is and what it represents and is it a publisher or is it this or is it that, I think we are missing out on a huge opportunity. So one really quick point about Facebook that we all talk about, but I really want to demonstrate. So Facebook is huge, and I want to show you how huge. So this is 1 million users, and this is what this looks like up close. So that's 1 million little dots right there on my screen, okay? So this is me scrolling through 1 million users on your screen, and that takes about 16 seconds to get done. So this is about 30 million users. This is about 100 million users. And this is 1.4 billion users, which is the number of people who log into Facebook every single day, every day. This is 1.9 billion users, which is the number of people who use Facebook every month. Here, for comparison, that little red line there up in the upper right-hand corner is the number of people who have ever logged into The Guardian since The Guardian had authentication. This is the number of New York Times subscribers. That's the population of Canada. This is the population of the United States. You may not know him, that is Carl Sagan. If you don't, you know, he's famous for billions and billions. I mean, Facebook is as big as the internet was in 2010. Now, we're not talking about 1996, we're talking about 2010. It is big. It is big, big, big. More importantly, Facebook is a reality. And I think this panel, the whole concept of this panel is, what are we missing? So now what? And with that, I am going to turn it over to these people who are going to answer that question. Garrett?
I'm actually going to go straight to Esra.
Oh. Right.
Lucky you. Surprise. And.
I think we need to turn that mic off. You don't want to go first, Garrett? No? Hello, everybody. Thanks for being here after lunch. Well done. My name is Esra Dogramaci, and I have been at Deutsche Welle for about 4 or 5 months now. Before that, I was at the BBC, and before that, I was at Al Jazeera. So I want to start off by actually showing you two things. So the first one is this. You know how Facebook comes up with this time 5 years ago you were doing this? So this came up on the 15th of March, and I was part of a team called the New Media Team at Al Jazeera, and we basically serviced across the board. It was Al Jazeera Arabic, and our main focus was Al Jazeera English. And on the 15th of March, 2012, we hit 2 million likes subscribers for Al Jazeera Arabic. And this is three of us from this team. We had a cake made. We were celebrating it in the Al Jazeera Arabic cafeteria, and nobody was interested. No one was interested and nobody was around us. And then, can we go to the second one, please? And then this is the second one. So this actually came up yesterday morning. So this time, 5 years ago, I'm like, yes, Al Jazeera English just hit 1 million followers and subscribers. And if you look at the likes, there's like 8 likes. So nobody cared about this. So we were part of this team that nobody really took us very seriously. They thought, oh, you guys are just updating Twitter and Facebook all day long. And like, yep, that's exactly what we're doing. And if you have no laughter, come on, yeah. Okay. And so if we have a look now, Al Jazeera English is now at 9 million, and Al Jazeera Arabic is at 21 million. That new media team doesn't exist anymore. And the reason that it doesn't exist anymore is because that function has basically been embedded into the newsroom. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, Aron basically mentioned a little bit, there are two problems here. The first problem is there are still those who don't accept Facebook and who don't accept digital. And I want to give you an example of it that I've been sharing over the last couple of days. Last week, I was speaking with an editor of a language service. And after about 90 minutes of trying to convince her why the video performance was very, very low, because there was no strategy, they were spamming their audience, the response that she basically gave me is, well, the reason that our view count is so low on our videos is because the audience hasn't discovered our videos yet, but they will in 1 or 2 years' time, because that's how the internet works. Yeah, I'm not making this up. So there are still people who think this way. The second problem is that everybody has drunk the Kool-Aid. Are you guys familiar with this expression? Everybody's kind of drunk from the well. And basically what I mean by that is there has been a lot of excitement over chasing numbers. So, sorry, AJ Plus, I really like you guys, but going on about 1 billion views doesn't really mean a thing. Okay, so we, hang on, you get your turn. So we have to be very particular about what are these kind of PR and vanity numbers versus what are actionable metrics. And related to that, I think there's a lack of people who understand and who can think strategically and implement what some of these things mean. Those people are hard to find, but those are the people who you need to get in. You need the people who are not painting the wall over people's eyes. You need people to come down and break it down and say, okay, views is very nice, but views is not the same thing as watch time or retention rate. And as we see organizations like Deutsche Welle saying we're going to be a digital organization and everybody is kind of going on this digital journey, you really need to have people who are honest, who understand what these things mean, and to be able to be educating your newsrooms, your editors, the people who are not necessarily digitally savvy. This is why, for example, in the work that I do and the strategies that I come up with, I'm never pursuing the aggregate. You're always going to have the Al Jazeera Arabic, Al Jazeera English, who will say, we have 21 million fans or 9 million. Or even, you know, Russia Today, how many of them are trolls? And actually, what are your rates of engagement and what are your rates of interaction, which is a lot more important. So it's always good if you're talking about a problem to actually be coming up with a solution. And I think that's what we're all here for. So I think what gets measured gets done, and these are kind of the three solutions that I have for it. So if you are, let's say you're a student, I think there's some volunteers, some like trainee people here, right? And maybe some kind of director media powerhouse people here as well. So for this two kind of, I won't say diametrically opposed, but related categories, the things that I would really encourage you to do is get to know what matters. Don't pay attention to views, don't pay attention to the PR numbers, pay attention to the actionable metrics and start to really interrogate your analytics. For students, you have this great resource available, CrowdTangle. Go talk to your CrowdTangle people, they are here. Since Facebook acquired this product, they've made this tool free for all the Facebook media partners and also for all journalism institutes. So go talk to these guys and make sure that you're getting these things in the house. I recently did an interview for the Global Editors Network where I was talking about this and how I think that the future of journalism is not just about technology, it's actually, are we setting the right digital foundation for people who are coming through the system right now? And I think the answer is no. One thing that you can be doing is get the tools in-house and become kind of digitally digitally literate. Number two, if you're an editor or a journalist, again, make sure you're getting things like CrowdTangle and realize that your competitors are not actually your competitors. So for example, I've got my buddy Sakhr here from AJ Plus. He's not my direct competitor. He's got a very different audience. The type of news that they're doing is very different, and we should be learning from each other, collaborating and talking to each other. And lastly, for people like me who's kind of coming from a more strategic standpoint, something that I've noticed largely missing in this conference is the discussion about women. People are talking about shares, likes, engagement, etc. I have not seen anybody, and especially in the areas that I've worked, nobody sets women as a target. So where am I coming from then? From that, there was I think it was a GMA study set between 2005 and 2015, tracking all media, and women only represented 25% of all media coverage. What's going on with the mic? Yeah, we good? Yeah. Okay, women only represented 25% of media coverage, and that's, I mean, stories about women. It extended from 36% in North America to 18% in EMEA region. So actually, no, Middle East and North Africa region. So are we in a position where we should be thinking, besides setting engagement targets and interaction targets, can we start to set audience targets that are saying, okay, my average interaction for women on Facebook is 21%, we want to take this to 30%, and then start to go up beyond there as well. And it is doable. We did do it at the BBC. There are a variety of metrics. As I mentioned, there's your PR numbers versus your actionable numbers. And also, if you're working in a scenario where none of this is being talked about, I really encourage disruption and just basically taking the bull by the horns and doing that kind of thing. If you get in trouble, just blame me. I'll be there to back you up. So with that, I'm going to hand it back to Aron or Garrett. Yeah.
Good. You guys can hear me? Okay, great. So I'll start with where I'm coming from. We have a video creation platform that empowers journalists to make video for digital audiences really easily, whether it's the video experts at CBS News using us or the new creators at The Telegraph and their social team. I'm Garrett Goodman. I run the partnerships team for Wochit, the company. And yeah, we work with 450 top media brands around the world. And their newspapers, their broadcasters, their radio stations, their pure players, digital natives. And one of the things that's really interesting about my job is that I get to see inside the video operations of all of these top publishers. And there's been a massive shift. There's been a massive shift towards social video. And actually what we see in our platform is that about 85% of the videos that are made without a voiceover and using text overlays. And when we compare that to 2 years ago, 100% of the videos were made with voiceover, right? So we can see that these leaders of the media are really shifting towards social video. And one of the things that I always ask, you know, when I start these conversations is what are you looking to get out of Facebook video? Why are you doing this? And one of the most common responses is we want to broaden our reach. We want to engage new people, we want to reach new audiences, we want to expose our brand to new people. As Aron was saying, Facebook presents an unprecedented opportunity to do this. And this is free distribution to a massive audience. So what we can see from the people that we're working with is that video is one of the best ways to get your brand in front of new people on Facebook. And actually working with Gruppo L'Espresso here in Italy, we saw that the video that was shared to their page from one of their local titles was actually shared 21 times more than any of the links that they were publishing, and 11 times more than any of the photos they were publishing. So it's the most powerful type of content that you can be putting on Facebook when it comes to engaging, getting shared, and reaching new audiences. But also another kind of common objection that I get is, well, why should I be doing stuff for Facebook if everything that everyone puts on Facebook looks exactly the same? How can I build my brand? How can I be distinctive? And that's true when you're dropping in a link and it gets sort of automatically formatted into this headline image. Everybody's links look roughly the same, but video is totally different. Video is not just a headline. Video is the story, and you get to tell it how you want and whatever tone of voice you choose is appropriate for your brand and with the visual style that represents your brand. So video is actually amazingly distinctive when it comes to Facebook. And I think that if you are going to pursue massive audiences and exposing your brand to new people, new demographics on Facebook, you have to do it in a way that's true to your brand. And this is one of the learnings that I got from Slate France that we're working with. I recently did an interview with their head of social, and he was telling me about kind of the approach that they take to it. And they said that it's really a slippery slope. It's easy to kind of do what everybody else is doing, chase the stories that everybody else chases, these viral hits. But if you want to build any kind of meaningful engagement and look towards getting loyal readers from what you're doing on Facebook, then you have to do it in a way that's true to your brand. So the first example that I'm going to show you guys today is from Slate. And when everybody was talking about how shitty a year 2016 was, they took a different approach and they said, look, this is 13 good things that actually happened in 2016. Playing and I'll kind of talk through it. One of the things that's amazing about this video is that it can be enjoyed without sound, right? So I can keep talking and you might get distracted unless you don't speak French, and then it should be fine. Anyways, this video, as it buffers, got almost 9 million views for Slate. And this is in the first month that they actually started making video that was specifically for a Facebook audience using Wochit. 9 million views, and what's even more important, as you were mentioning, Esra, is that they got 200,000 shares, just under 200,000 shares. Like, that is massive engagement for this tiny little page. And if you want to look at impact and what that really means for them, in the 10 days following the posting of this video, they gained more fans to their Facebook page than they had in the 4 months prior. So for them, using Facebook as a way to reach new engaged audiences, and using video in particular, was massively successful. There's another objective that we hear when it comes to Facebook and video in particular, and often it comes as an objection, which is, why would I make video specifically for a Facebook audience if I can't monetize it? The truth is you can monetize it, first of all. Right, it's called branded content. Lots of people are doing it. I've got an example to share with you. But honestly, the thing that you can't do now is stick crappy pre-roll advertising in front of your video, and that's a good thing. Like, Facebook is saving you from yourself if that's really what you want to do. Because we've seen that display advertising is so invasive and so interruptive that hordes of audience members have gone and actually installed ad blockers so they don't have to deal with that anymore. So the idea of monetizing on Facebook with some simple plugin and ad code, and we're gonna disrupt, you know, the attention that we're actually earning from our audience, I think is pretty short-sighted. Now, if you wanna look at branded content, there's a massive opportunity there. And Facebook has actually just recently even broadened that program. So more people can get involved in posting branded content, and brands can have more visibility in these videos. So this is an example from Now This, who we're also working with. And this video, as you can see, it's tagged Now This. Now you can see it's tagged Now This with Loving. So you can see that actually there's a sponsor involved in this video. And Facebook is getting even better about making sure that this is clearly something that was paid for or sponsored by a brand. We'll be right back. going. Keep going. Okay. I'll tweet it out afterwards. It's actually a really heartwarming video. And the point is that when this branded content is done properly, the story is interesting to the audience, and there's an uplift to the publisher and to the brand, right? It doesn't have to be crappy advertising. It can be really engaging, interesting content. And if you look at the number of views on this, 13 million views, right? It was very interesting for quite a big audience. Okay, we're not gonna get any more out of that. The branding is also really subtle on this. It doesn't come until the very end when they give a little tiny call to action that says, go see the movie Loving, which is about this historical couple, mixed race couple. So if you're trying to make money on Facebook, branded content is the way forward for now, unless you want to try and do some kind of mid-roll stuff when Facebook finally opens it up, but you're probably not doing yourself any favors because, as we've seen, audiences don't particularly like the traditional display approach. And if you are trying to monetize, you probably need to build your audience on there first, so you probably need to go through that first step of creating video that's really on brand, that really attracts an audience that's actually there for what you have to offer, not just every single viral story that everybody else is doing. I'm Garrett Goodman from Wochit. Check us out.
And just before you start, there's 7 seats in the front here if anybody wants to come and be friends with us. No?
They're scared.
Yeah, we got some movement. All right.
All right. I'm going to start with by saying television news is dead. I said this yesterday, and it shocked people, so I'm going to keep saying it until people realize. My name is Sakhr Al-Makhadhi. I'm Middle East editor at AJ+. And I think it's really important to get the idea that TV news packages haven't really developed or changed since the 1950s. But viewers have changed, and especially viewers who are watching our videos on Facebook. They've changed, and they're changing us. They're changing the way we produce news, the way we present stories. And unless broadcasters realize it, they're no longer going to exist. They're no longer going to be relevant at some point. Journalism, in my opinion, TV news journalism has moved so far away from the people it serves that it's no longer relevant. And Facebook and audiences on Facebook have forced us to realize that we need to move a lot closer to our audiences, to embed ourselves within the audiences that we serve, to tell the stories of the people we serve. And one of the great ways that it forces us to do that is through this idea of engagement. So yeah, 9 million Facebook page likes does matter, but engagement matters more, in my opinion. And the reason engagement matters more is because that's how we reach new audiences. When people like and share and comment on our videos, it pushes our videos to people who may not know anything about AJ+, or may not know anything about our brand, and it reaches those new audiences. So it's not an optional extra. It's not something like in the old days we used to talk about interactive, you know, press the red button and comment on our story now and send us a message now. It's not some optional extra that's tagged on to the editorial. It's something intrinsic, and it's something right at the heart of everything we do. We need to be aware of our audiences, because viewers now are part of the news cycle. They often know more about the story than we do when we're starting a story. They will follow us, they will be on that journey with us through the production of a story. And they're often a source of stories for us as well. So we'll dive into the comments on Facebook, and people will be sharing their own personal stories. And we've traced these stories and got in contact with people and produced follow-up stories that have pushed our original narrative along even further. And so there's this great feedback loop now where we're working with our audience to develop our stories and also to fact check as well. You know, that I think there is really a huge burden of fact checking on us, a greater burden than in television news, because when a TV news package goes out, that's it, it's out. The only people who are gonna complain are, you know, your colleagues if they think you've done something wrong. Now, the whole world can see when we've made a mistake, because that comment will be visible to the public. So viewers are demanding more, but they're also coming at our stories in a different way. Instead of people sitting down in front of the television and coming to the story, we're now trying to push our story to them. And that has two effects. First of all, it imposes demands on us creatively and stylistically to format our stories for a new type of audience on Facebook, and also, you know, this dark art of the Facebook algorithm. We have to tailor visually our stories to work within the Facebook algorithm to make sure that we can get a viewer to stay on our video as they're scrolling past it. But also ethically as well, I think it does, it changes the way we need to think about how we present news to an audience. In the old days, you know, if it was after the watershed, if it was after 9 p.m., a video could safely be shown. But now, viewers are not, viewers might not be expecting to see gruesome scenes of death and destruction and you know, mutilated bodies. So we have to be more aware of how we present certain types of stories. But I think that we need to move past, it should be very obvious by now, but we need to move past the idea of dumping television news packages online. It doesn't work anymore. The audience has changed, and it's very different. And I think that print media realized this in the 1990s, and they realized that you couldn't just put a broadsheet newspaper online with buttons that you could flick through. Print realized that in the 1990s. 20 years on, some broadcasters still haven't picked up on the fact that online and social news is so very different to old school linear broadcasting. So we need to realize that we have a very different relationship with our audience. We're working with our audience now instead of just presenting a story to them. And I think one of the successes that we've had at AJ Plus is realizing that these new audiences, these are not just new audiences on new platforms. These are people who are changing the way that we are telling the stories. And if we wake up to that, we can be successful on Facebook, but sticking with the old school idea of what television news is not going to be the right way for television news or for the viewers. So I think it's social news and a more media literate audience have really forced a change in the way that we tell stories.
Okay, great. So, I mean, you got a ton of ideas about monetization. You had a ton of ideas about democratizing production of video and getting it to an audience. You got a ton of ideas about how to measure success. You got a ton of ideas about how to approach this. You got a ton of ideas about the right kind of social video and the wrong kinds of social video. So you got your money's worth so far, and we've got like a half an hour left, so awesome. I have one question for you, and I'd love to then open it up to the rest of you. It's kind of a toss-up. Actually, I'd love to hear everybody's answer to this. I mean, if you go back and look at every single time a new platform has sort of emerged, the assumptions we make about it from a quote-unquote best practices standpoint was 100% wrong. We were wrong about how people wanted to engage with mobile. Remember, snackable content? We were wrong about how people wanted to engage with content on tablets. We were wrong about how people wanted to view video. We're wrong about how to approach social media writ large and social video in particular. Wrong, 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 wrong. So you've talked about many of the things that we and others, you and others, are doing right. What is the one thing you see that people are doing wrong and need to stop? Maybe we'll just start with you, Ezra.
Leadership. And there's a very specific reason why I said that, because in my digital journey, I have discovered that, and I know there's some very good people here, so Blanid, Inky, I think are folks who are doing it right. And the reason that they're doing it right is because they're listening. I won't say that we've grown up with the platforms, but it's definitely become part of our lives, so we know how to use it inherently. But too often, and I mentioned this yesterday, no offense to everyone, I love you all, but I find that a lot of people, particularly a lot of editors and leadership, have come into this thinking that social media is basically advertising for the website or for the newspaper model, which they're familiar with. So, and in an example I gave again in this Gen article that I did with Marianne in the back here, was that, hang on, I'm getting distracted by the baby again. Can I just like stick her here and she's my presentation? Seriously, like, I seriously like lost my train.
That's
of
fine.
So we're talking about leadership. No, yes, I know. Okay, so like, let's take for an example. You have a teenager in the U.S. who's on Snapchat, uses it for news consumption, sharing everything like that. And then what I see is some like 50-year-old usually male editors like, oh, Snapchat, here's your strategy, go. Yeah. And it's not part of their lives. They don't really use it. And even just recently, another kind of colleague of ours was saying, oh, there was this really innovative editor at unnamed organization who was doing all the social stuff and isn't even on Instagram. And they were doing Instagram strategy and that kind of thing. And I mean, one of the inherent things that we used to talk about at Al Jazeera is that, number one, if you're going to work in social media, yeah, you need to be social. And number two, you need to be authentic. So how authentic are you going to be if you're not active and you're not engaging on these platforms? What are you going to do? So that's why I said leadership. The other reason why leadership is really important is because you have these kind of wrecking ball people like myself, and you're probably one of them too, right? And we come in and just shake. Garrett knows this really well. So, you know, you come in and shake the tree. And I think if you don't have leaders that are going to be back you up and...
Hi, Natalie.
Oh, no.
We scared Natalie.
Too much excitement.
So we'll get to your question in a minute, Natalie.
Yeah. So, you know, I think in any kind of inevitable change, you're going to be making people really uncomfortable, whether it's going to your audience's team and telling that the metrics that they've been giving you are wrong. For example, reaches and impressions doesn't count for anything. They're good PR numbers. But you want to be paying attention to things like watch time, retention rate, your total interactions, engagement. Again, shout out for CrowdTangle. You know, if you guys aren't on it, you need to be on it. Your leadership needs to basically back you up because you have so many people who are invested in the old way of doing things. So, yeah, if you don't have this tone coming from above, it's not going to happen. And then the other thing, again, I mentioned this yesterday, is journalism works because it's repeatable. It's on some kind of pattern. Digital has completely shaken the tree because if you want to be advancing in digital, you need to be carving out the time and space to be doing innovative stuff. Google is doing this right. You have your 20% time. News organizations should be doing it too. I'm not saying for everybody, but you've got to carve out the time and space to allow people to be experimenting things without the pressure to publish. Sorry. But I mean, we try to do this in a few places I've been in, and what we noticed is if you're shaking the tree and you're doing something different, you're surrounded by people who have a very traditional mindset. So it's very, very easy for them to kind of suck you into it and be like, why are you playing on your phone? Why are you doing this on Facebook? Why aren't you writing articles? And like, you know, basically, you know this scene in The Simpsons where there's the chain-smoking monkeys chained to their desks? Yeah, like, that's what they want to see you doing. And like, I'm not going to be a chain-smoking monkey. So, but I mean, that's the two things that I'm getting at. Like, you really have to kind of be committed to that disruption, and you need to have somebody really strong to backstop you when you're doing that disruption.
I think the authenticity is so important, and I think audiences figure it out really quickly when people who aren't on Facebook or Twitter are trying to tell stories on Facebook and Twitter. And I think one of the most important things for me, and this is similar to what you were saying, Esra, is that you need to have a startup culture. You need to have this culture of trial and error and making mistakes and figuring out what works on different platforms and with different audiences. Because if you don't do that, you won't figure out what works. And another part is working with organizations such as Facebook to figure out how their algorithms work and how what they're planning in the future and how you can produce stories that work within that ecosystem. But yeah, the main thing is working within the startup culture and kind of realizing that culturally we're closer to startups in Silicon Valley than old school journalism. The idea of collaboration and sharing, and I don't mean that in the vague business sense of the word, I mean literally sharing rivals' videos on Facebook. Can you imagine if BBC News on television ran a promo for a Channel 4 news package on TV? I can't get my head around this idea, but we would happily share a Channel 4 news video on AJ Plus. And they're one of our, you know, what you would perceive as one of our direct rivals. And so it's changing the way that we perceive the relationship with our audience and with the platforms that we're working on. Everything's different. The whole world has changed. It's the only thing that's similar is that we tell stories.
Mm. I want to add something to this. So a lot of question I get when I talk about this is, okay, how can we do it? And I remember once being asked a question of, these ideas are all great, but really busy. And my response was basically, which got people a little bit upset, was busy. When you use busy as an excuse, it demonstrates your lack of ability to prioritize. Mm. Because if you're working in the, so there you go, I said it. So if you're looking in the digital world, the thing that we have is analytics, right? So look at your long tail. Usually 20% of your metrics, no, 80% of your performance is coming from 20% of your content. So see what you can kind of mitigate and then cut your losses and then move on very quickly. Maybe Charlie Beckett might not agree with me. Charlie's not here, so I can say what I want. So he says you should rescue the long tail. But I think you should let the long tail go and just focus on doing something well. I think that's how you could be doing it. Once you and also if you're bringing in things like, you know, SocialFlow, Chartbeat, CrowdTangle, Google Analytics, all these amazing tools, that's going to free up your time to be investing in your experimentation and your startup type of things.
Totally. And I think the idea of being busy as well is also an excuse to keep doing the same things you've been doing for 50 years. Right. It's an excuse not to try something new because people are scared.
Right. I mean, just a quick anecdote to your point about this is I had an honest-to-God discussion with an editor not that long ago who was looking at a story that got 5,000 page views. Okay, 5,000 page views is an accident. I mean, that's like, you know, that's probably 80% bots. You know, that's not even mostly real human beings. And I'm like, how on earth does something like this even get commissioned? And the answer was, well, that's 5,000 page views we wouldn't have had otherwise. And I think people really do not understand. They look at 5,000 page views and say, okay, that's winning the internet. And it's not, and it's really not. They don't understand how the monetization side works. They don't understand how little, I mean, that's fractions of a penny right there that you did. And how many hours did you spend reporting and writing that story that got 5,000 page views? I think part of understanding the economics of the web, too, and the economics of social is really important. Sorry, Garrett, you.
Yeah, so I wanted to plus one what you said about leadership. It's something that I see firsthand all the time when we're running pilots with publishers and they give access to Wochit to a bunch of people and they say, okay, so this is a cool tool, just try it out. And you're like, oh my God, you know, you have access to this really transformative piece of software that could really empower a lot of journalists, and instead of giving them some structure and some support and some clear objectives, a little bit of carrot and a little bit of stick, you're just saying, here, do this on top of everything else that you already do because you don't have enough work on your plate. And it's like completely destined to fail. So having more of an appreciation for how much workload the individuals have and understanding how you can make space for them to experiment and try new things, I think is absolutely essential. When it comes to what I've seen for mistakes people have made trying to do video for social, there is, as everybody is resource starved, or most people are resource starved, there is an inclination to just do this one size fits all approach to video, right? Like, I'm gonna do my story, it's gonna be 16:9, it's gonna be based on what I think is the gold standard, which is website traffic, because at least I can put pre-roll ads in front of there. And then I'm gonna cross-post it onto social, and lo and behold, it doesn't engage, it doesn't get viewed, it doesn't get shared. And it's pretty obvious. Like, think about the context of how people are consuming that content. It's completely different if somebody comes to your website or comes to YouTube. They're showing intent to see your specific content. If you're trying to get their attention by jumping out of their Facebook feed as they're scrolling through Facebook, not through your specific property, then you need to treat that package completely differently. So I think, and this is something that AJ Plus does extremely well. I think this is something that Now This does extremely well. But approaching each platform and understanding the context of consumption is essential to actually having success on that platform. Another thing that I see a lot, and it seems, again, like an easy approach, is let's create some teasers of full-length videos, and let's put those teasers on Facebook. And actually, the conversion rate is abysmal. And usually, that strategy doesn't last very long if people are paying attention to the numbers. Facebook, if you're doing video for Facebook, from our experience, it needs to be able to live on its own. It can be a specific angle of a much larger piece, but you need to tell that story completely enough that it is compelling enough to be shared. If you're just teasing something greater, then it's a disappointment.
You know, to your point, it's amazing to me how people's perception of Facebook as a traffic driving, a vehicle to drive traffic to the thing that really matters, which is your website or apps or mobile site. When in fact, that's exactly the wrong way to think about it. And when in fact, you should be thinking it was a completely separate channel. And yet, these same publishers are lining up in Venice, California, to get into Snapchat, which you can't. You have to produce Discover as a bespoke thing. You need to hire very expensive, discreet staff to run it. And never do these two things. Do somebody say, maybe we should take a similar approach with Facebook? I don't know. It's very strange. So questions. Yes. Wait, do we have a mic? Do we have a mic?
Quick plug on Snapchat. We have a session tomorrow with Le Monde Snapchat editor. He's going to tell you how they do Discover.
Quick plug for Gen Summit. The Data Journalism Awards are still open. Enter now.
Any other plugs? No? Any plugs out there? Okay.
We're up for 4 Webbies, but first.
Yeah, I think Le Monde may tell you that they are doing Snapchat experiment with other people's money and not their own.
Yeah.
Aron, you raised the money question, right? I mean, I hear what you're all saying, but Deutsche Welle and AJ Plus are not making their own money. And I think when you speak to even forward-looking editors and publishers, having another way of giving away their content for free is probably not top of sort of their list of priorities. Mm. So can you say a little bit more about the monetization side of this?
Can I put two quick things in? One of the fun facts I'll throw out. People who came to The Guardian and had liked The Guardian's page on Facebook were orders of magnitude more likely to become a member, to become regular readers of The Guardian, who then become, you know, much easier to convert long run. That's fun fact number one. Fun fact number two, if we think about Facebook as a discrete channel, monetization channel, as a way to monetize the way Garrett was describing through native or, God forbid, you know, mid-roll, that's one way to think about it. The other thing, though, that I should point out is the assumption that because you are producing at great expense this video on your website, and that those websites are making a lot of money, those publishers, those traditional publishers, particularly on the newspaper side, are making a lot of money out of that, is not a correct assumption. There's a lot of publishers who are spending a lot of money on video, hoping to generate a ton of streams on site and not doing it. So honestly, I'm not sure that the old strategy is working any better than the strategy we're talking about up here. So
that's a good question, Rasmus. And I think when I'm having these discussions, I can't name any names, but I've heard multiple times from publishers that brands are approaching them to sponsor specific videos that their editorial team has already made, right? We're not talking about bespoke content for a brand. We're talking about like a sponsored video that fetched 20,000, 30,000 pounds for the sponsorship of one video. Like, that's a lot of money, right? When you compare that to what you could make with one video on pre-roll advertising, it's orders of magnitude higher. So there's a real opportunity there. There's another way that the publishers that I've heard are approaching monetization when it comes to Facebook video in particular, which is that Facebook video is used as a vehicle to grow their reach, to get more eyeballs on their content, so that they're not looking at it for a direct click back to the website with the video per se, but it's more nuanced. When they add a link subsequently to that page, they're getting more traffic back, and we've seen that happen time and again. So there are ways of getting value out of the Facebook activity when it comes to video, but branded content, really, if you think about it, how many publishers are actually really trying to monetize Facebook?
Can I lob in here? Yeah. Just on this point again, and Rasmus, and if you haven't read the Jen interview yet in this time, we mentioned this as well. So if you have a look at the traditional media landscape, it doesn't have a lot of money. And we're constantly trying to come up with innovations to do different things. But actually, there's an industry that's really, really close to us that we could be looking for inspiration, and that is the entertainment industry. And what I would really like to see, kind of in my fantasy Esra world of news organizations doing, is what would be stopping, for example, I don't know, like, let's just say the BBC, perhaps, of partnering up with Amazon in this era of fake news, to be doing collaborative projects together, or, you know, Deutsche Welle or Al Jazeera or whatever, because they are the ones that are advanced, and this kind of brings technology into the debate as well. Like, VR is not at the consumer price point yet, but on Jimmy Fallon, you will see him testing Google Tilt Brush or Google Paint Brush and this kinds of things. So why are, I mean, you were speaking about branded content, but can we just widen this a little bit more and see why aren't we collaborating with Amazon or Netflix or BuzzFeed Studios to be doing more kind of news partnerships, borrowing their expertise when it's coming to innovation and a lot more creativity, rather than trying to necessarily build these things in-house and doing a very bad job at it.
Questions? Who else? Seriously? No one?
Oh, yes.
All right.
So we talk a lot always about, you know, working with platforms and, you know, also sort of the, we're collaborators, but ultimately it's their platforms at the end of the day, so it's a love-hate relationship. But do you ever see a future in which media companies could work together almost in a venture capital kind of realm where we would seed fund early, you know, early point, you know, companies that could be the next platforms so that we sort of get early stakes and help them develop and put more of a print and a shape on them ourselves. And I mean it not, you know, as like individually maybe companies doing it, but sort of banding together in more of a collaborative effort. Do you think that that's something that could ever happen?
So this was before your time, but at Al Jazeera New Media back in the day, we had exactly that same idea. And I think people just thought we were crazy and nobody believed it and wouldn't do it. But yeah, I would be totally open to doing something like that, especially, you know, Berlin startup scene, Deutsche Welle owns the European landscape, right? So you've got these big broadcasters at top, so CNN, Sky, Al Jazeera, BBC, et cetera. You've got your lower tier, Russia Today, et cetera. And then you've got these guys in the middle, perhaps, depending on who you talk to, okay? So then you've got like your Euronews, France 24, Deutsche Welle, et cetera. And so, again, we're not necessarily competitors. We're going after different things. Why are we not banding together and say, hey, DW, you know, the Berlin tech media landscape. Why can't we get together and do something, you know? Yeah.
I mean, you have Blendle, right, which is a pretty good example of publishers putting money into figuring out some kind of platform that can save journalism. And I think that's to be lauded, although with results remain to be seen, like whether or not that will actually work with that approach. But there is precedent for that, I think. But it's really tough.
I mean, I don't think us doing it, you know, in the sense of, I don't think we as a
right.
I don't think we need to own the platforms. I don't think we need to be worried about that. You know, we jumped onto Facebook because it had built up an audience with people sharing their status updates and holiday photos, and it was already massively popular by the time news producers jumped onto it. And I think it's like television, you know. The BBC would never have imagined building television sets, and that's not a problem. They're the experts at platforms and we're the experts at content production. And yeah, there are still issues to be figured out in terms of monetization and how that relationship works, but that's the future. That's where the path is going, to figure out that relationship. I don't think we need to replace Facebook and Twitter and YouTube.
Other question?
As you mentioned, of course, 2 years ago, one could not have thought about the fact that almost all of the videos now are not voice-overed. And now I just go through my feed and I get really bored because all of the content I see is videos, videos, videos with text. And I'm just thinking, where can it go next? What do you guys think is coming next? Because I really don't want this to continue.
It's often pretty cyclical. Like, we've been watching, so first of all, it's worth saying that it's different from market to market, right? Like, country to country, they work at different speeds. And we can see in some of the places that we're active that adoption by publishers of Facebook and creating video specifically for Facebook is just not even on their radar. And they're doing much more traditional video packages. And maybe they're thinking about a web audience, but it's got a voiceover. Maybe even there's a piece to camera at times, you know, with a journalist sitting there. So it's not all like that, but it can seem that way if you're in one of the more developed markets. And we've just recently heard that Facebook is looking at turning on sound by default, right? So they're, and maybe the Facebookers in the room can tell us a little bit more about that, but I think they're constantly changing the rules, which means that we have to stay nimble. And the idea of building these crazy expensive video operations that take super long to make any video and basically negate any opportunity for experimentation is just the wrong path. And so I don't know what the future is going to look like, but it's certainly not going to look all the same. One thing I would say about this idea of like all the videos having text on top of them is that you do hear some people saying that their objective is actually to get people to turn on the sound. Like for them, that's a win. If they can create a piece of content and craft it in a way that's interesting enough that actually the audience member wants to stop scrolling and click to engage with that piece of video on Facebook, then that's their objective. And I think that's an interesting approach too.
Why did AJ Plus do so well so quickly? Because depending on who you talk to, they do stories that matter, right? And they also have an opinion with the stories. If you had a look at what Channel 4 was doing with news last year, they were very, very selective about what they did, and all of their stories were just charged with emotion. The example, again, in the yesterday session, which I showed for the New York Times, it kind of broke all of the rules. It was 16 by 9. There was sound involved, and so you wanted to engage with it and tune it in, turn it up, and like watch through the whole way. So I think on the one side, you're going to see less of this cookie-cutter approach, because everybody's kind of like racing to get there, but we're moving on. Now, on the publisher side, when you're looking at the numbers, you can see the engagement, right? And so I think for people who know how to use the numbers and interpret the numbers, you're going to be looking at engagement. And if you see them going somewhere else and your numbers are dropping, you're going to realize that, uh-oh, we're not doing something right here. What is it that we need to be doing? And I think like the New York Times has always been a pioneer for this, saying, this is our digital strategy, this is what we're going to do, right? Everybody's waiting for like the next report to like land so we can photocopy it and send it to people. And I think a lot of other news organizations aren't doing that. They're always like, oh, you're doing this, I'm doing this, so I guess I should do it too, rather than figuring out what they stand for. So maybe that's the first thing, like, okay, what do you guys stand for? Are you doing breaking news? Are you doing features? Are you going to do like a VR experiment? Whatever it is, figure that out first, and then, you know, if you build it, they will come.
That's the dream.
That's the dream.
Hi. Is it on?
Yes.
Hello. I've got a question about editorial integrity, especially for companies who don't have the privilege of already having a huge number of subscribers. So say you've got a news story that breaks, and you've got three options in front of you. You've got a company who approaches you and offers you, do the video this way for social branded content, and we'll give you a chunk of money. Someone from your social team comes and says, no, do it this way. It's you know, funky, cuts out a lot of the information, but you'll reach more people, you might get more subscribers. But in the heart of hearts, the editor knows that the third option will tell the story the best way, will be true to the facts, and will probably communicate the story best, but might not reach as many people. Who do you honestly think they're going to choose? And do the first two options undermine the editorial integrity of the brand?
You've got two competing things going here. You've got a business motivation and an audience motivation, so you need to split the two and decide which one's important for you. Are you going for revenue, or are you going for engagement on your native platform? So your question is actually two parts. So that's the first decision to make. The second thing that you've got to do, again, you're working in the digital world, follow the numbers. The numbers are going to tell you, are going to give you the answer to that question.
And I think that, you know, in every media organization, there should be a red line between, or a firewall between, money and editorial, and those should never meet, and editorial should never be directed by where the money is. So they have to be kept separate. There's no change of rules just because we're on social now. But yeah, in terms of reaching a bigger audience or being directed, you know, by what social wants or by what, you know, the purest editorial approach should be. Of course, we're journalists. We want to reach the biggest audience possible, and we have to shape creatively the way that we present our output for different platforms to reach the biggest audiences. Otherwise, there's no point doing this. Otherwise, you know, I could give you a 5,000-word essay and dump that on Facebook, and no one will read it. But it's editorially pure and clean. There's no point doing that. I mean, we have to be led by, in some cases, have to be led by the visuals if the visuals are stunning. And sometimes you have to select stories because the visuals are stunning and shape the editorial around that. And sometimes it works the other way around. But we have to accept that a platform exists and an audience is demanding certain things.
Also, luckily, I think that first scenario probably never happens. Like, breaking news is not really a commercial opportunity and never has been a big money maker, right? So if you're going to have somebody come and present an opportunity to brand some piece of content, it's much less likely to be hard news than it is to be something a little softer, probably a little bit more evergreen because they want to get their money's worth. So hopefully it's just a question of deciding between social native cut or maybe a big online like on-site piece, which has got a different approach. But I guess also there's a case to be made for experimentation, like see what works best. It's all based on assumptions, but we constantly have to test our assumptions about what formats are engaging best. And I think there's something really interesting that now this talks about. They talk about the strategy of raising the floor and looking at, of all of the content that they make, what's the bottom 25% and how could they do that better instead of trying to chase viral hits, because they talk about how virality is not a strategy. And sorry that I keep mentioning now this on the panel, but I think that that's a really smart approach to figuring out what is working and just stop doing stuff that's not performing. I mean, it sounds so obvious, right?
Time for one more quick question. Anyone?
Everybody wants gelato. That's what.
Everyone wants gelato? Okay, well, I don't want to keep anybody fat. Oh, you know what? Damn, I forgot to mention. I wore my Mark Zuckerberg costume today, and I totally forgot to mention it. Oh, well. All right. Well, look, thank you all for being here. Thank you all for being here. I hope you found it worthwhile. Thank you.
Thank you.